And when they said unto thee, let us go into the house of the Lord. And I'm so glad that you're here this morning. And we're here to worship and praise and lift up our Lord and Savior. Watch the screen as we begin the service.
Shit. 305, please, and my heart there rings a melody. I have a song that Jesus gave me.
Thank you.
see each of you this morning. What a blessed day it is to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Out of the vestibule, if you are interested, there is an article written by John MacArthur, pastor of the Grace Community Church in the Los Angeles area. And John MacArthur has put an article together on the biblical case for the church's duty to remain open. And he gives a very tremendous scriptural presentation of why the church should be open rather than closed. Now, I made a commitment back in March, come hell or high water, we were going to have church. Now, you may not want to be here, but I'm going to be here. The door's going to be open.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm willing to go to jail to keep the church doors, these church doors open.
Amen.
I believe we render to Caesar what is Caesar's.
Right.
And we render to Christ what is Christ. Christ is the head of the church.
Right.
The church belongs to Christ. The church is his bride. And therefore, we serve Christ, not Caesar, with the church. John MacArthur, of course, California, they're really putting the twist and the pressure on churches in California. And I've not always agreed with John MacArthur on some issues, especially on Calvinism. But I've always respected him and admired him as a Bible teacher. But this particular article, and by the way, I have signed this as a pastor, that this is where I stand. And we put that out of the vestibule, if you want a copy of it. We've also put it on our webpage of BibleBaptistHearing.com. That's on our webpage also, this particular article. But he's really stating in a very intellectual way what I have said and what I believe and so forth. And it's just well done. It's well presented from a biblical standpoint. And again, if we call ourselves Bible believers, we've got to practice and believe the Bible. Yep. I mean, that's my feeling, and so forth. And so I wanted to make that available. Again, just a couple of announcements. Don't forget, we have at 10:30 is coffee and fellowship for those that want to come for refreshments and so forth at 10:30 before the 11 o'clock service. Again, we have food bank this week, and Chuck comes on Friday to unload if you want to come help at about 8 o'clock, and then Saturday morning around 9 o'clock, we actually open. We our hours are from 10 to 11:30, but they literally start at about 9 o'clock. And again, that's been so tremendous. The ladies have their lawn chair luncheon at Sandstone Ranch and on the 17th, and which is Monday, a week away. And so they'll be having that super lot. Again, it's hard to see possible that Operation Christmas Child is coming quickly, and the putting together those Christmas boxes for Operation Christmas Child, and Jan Cavender is heading that up and does such a tremendous job at that. And so they're going to be putting those boxes, shoe boxes together for Operation Christmas Child. So be thinking about that and planning for that. Our missionaries of the month are the Schertzers down in Belize. And Brother James is going to come and share a little bit with us about the latest happenings of the Schertzers. This pandemic has affected, where it's global, of course, as far as affecting people, it's really affected the missionaries, again, all across the globe that we support. The church is one of the young couples that our church supports that just is a tremendous young couple doing a great job in Belize. Brother James, share with us about that.
Well, this is their latest letter dated April, June of this year. This is a real interesting couple. They're very excitable. Dear praying churches, family, and friends, greetings from Belize. Lockdowns and quarantines may seem to limit our opportunities to serve God is not hindered by regulations. These past couple months have proven to be very fruitful in His glory. Their food distribution ministry during the lockdown, we packed 75 to 100 bags of basic food supplies each week. I distributed the bags of food along with gospel tracts and Bible studies to the church families, who then passed the bags out to people in their area. What a blessing to watch our church families get excited about the opportunity to give. It has opened many doors for us to share the gospel with new families. Praise God for the salvation of a young man named Damien. Please pray for his wife Dorothy to be saved. As regulations continue to lift and people go back to work, we have finished the distribution ministry. However, we continue to visit families on a weekly basis. Now, this I found interesting, and they have it written in bold letters. Pray specifically for Brian and Ermina, as well as Geraldo and Melissa. Both couples need to be saved, but are working through deep spiritual confusion. Their online services, they are weekly online services, and they also provide unique results. Many extended families who don't regularly attend church watch the services. A church family told us about their elderly father, who especially enjoyed watching Elizabeth's children learn about salvation of a witch doctor and his daughter. He was a former witch doctor's apprentice himself and could explain the witch doctor's voodoo rituals throughout the weekly online lessons. Please pray for Lorenzo's salvation. As church resumes in June, churches began to reopen with heavy restrictions, such as 10 people or less, social distancing, no children under 12, masks at all time, no bus route. However, by the end of the month, many of the restrictions had lifted. Praise God.
Amen.
He puts a power punch on that. So. But people are still required to wear masks and practice social distancing. It is a joy gathering again. I don't normally iterate here, but I know when Pastor shut down for what, one Sunday? One Sunday. That man went nuts. But amen. I agree, you know, this the church belongs to God. So they have a new baby, and in the midst of the this COVID-19 chaos, our family was thrilled to welcome Julia Faith Scherzer on May 22nd. Amen. Now, Julia informed me this is their fourth child. So it was quite an experience delivering the baby in a third world country during the pandemic. But God answered many specific prayers. Can you imagine? Praise God for the great birth. Elizabeth dealt with some complications after the birth due to an infection, but she's back to full health and enjoying her new routine as a mommy of four. We are so thankful for many prayers and messages of encouragement during this time. Through these unusual times, God never ceases to ultimately claim the victory. We can never thank you enough for the crucial part each of you play in the ministry. Though we know many of you face your own hardships and trials, we continue to faithfully give to God's work here. Our hearts are so humbled by your sacrifices. Reach and Belize for Christ, Jonathan and Elizabeth, Rachel, Joshua, Anna, and Julia Scherzer.
Amen.
The Scherzers are, again, one of those exciting young couples serving the Lord down in Belize. They're our missionary of the month. We've supported for a number of years. We took them on when they had one child. They've had three children since then. Let me just mention a couple of prayer requests. I've been mentioning Jerry Hubbard, who has had a horrible case of shingles and so forth. And I talked to him this week, and he's still struggling. He says, I think the pain's gone, and then it just comes in full force. Also, Janice Johnson had back surgery on Friday, and she's recovering at home, and I had a text from her this morning saying that she still has some real pain in the incision, and they were going to stay home, so our prayers are with Janice. And then somebody asked me about Lisa Navarez. Lisa had fallen last weekend, wasn't here, but Lisa is okay. She still has a pretty good gash in her knee, and they did go to the emergency, and she didn't have any broken ribs, which they were fearful of. They're in, their granddaughter was getting baptized today up in Greeley, Evans, or wherever they're at, I'm not sure, but up in there. So her and Sam are there this morning, and she's doing fine. All right, I think that's all of the announcements. Susan,
Brother Herb had back surgery too.
That's right, Herb had back surgery, and I talked to Herb Thursday, I believe it was, and said he was doing good, sounded good, and etc. So, Brother Herb and Susan.
That was the one I was going to.
Oh, okay, for Brother Herb. All right, I believe that's everything, Brother Terry.
Ridge 470, please. 470, a wonderful piece. 470. 470. 470.
Away in the depths of my spirit, no melody sweeter than song.
Is it on there?
This is the same one you used.
Yeah, it's online.
good. Just do it, Chuck. I'm on.
Just go ahead and sing.
Just sing.
Killed it.
Is it dead?
It was on for you.
Oh, no?
No, it was.
Oh.
No, okay, never mind. She just went to a different channel.
Oh, okay.
When it comes to one another.
Amen.
We find that term, one another, through the scripture. We learned in 1 John chapter 4 that we are to love one another. Jesus said in John chapter 13, verse 34, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. For by this shall all men know you are my disciples. Why? Because you love one another. Last week we talked about not judging one another. God doesn't want us judging one another. And today I want to speak about bearing or accepting one another. I'm going to read first from Ephesians chapter 4. Let's stand together as we look at the Word of God. I want you to follow as I read. The screen has the King James. I'm reading from the New King James. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. How were we called? Verse 2. With all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So he's telling us here, he's begging us in the sense, he says, I beseech you in verse 1, and he says that you walk worthy of your calling, and then he tells us what that calling is in verse 2, that our calling is that we're to walk with lowliness, gentleness, long-suffering, and bearing with one another, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit. Now, Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15. I want to read the first 7 verses. Romans chapter 15. We then, who are strong, ought to bear with the scruples or the infirmities of the weak, and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good, leading to edification. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached him fell on me. For whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we through the patience and comfort of the Scripture might have hope. Now, may the God of patience and comfort grant you to be like-minded toward one another, according to Christ Jesus, that you may with one mind and one mouth glorify God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 7. Therefore, receive or accept one another, just as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us again an opportunity to open your word. That word that lives, that word that's powerful, that word that, again, is God-breathed. And Lord, I pray that, again, that as believers, we may see how important it is for us to go the second mile with one another, even to the point of bearing and accepting one another, even though we may disagree in our own personal preferences. And now I pray, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh upon us and teach us your word in Christ. I pray, amen and amen. God bless you. Be seated, please. I have some good news and some bad news this morning. The good news is, if you have received Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're going to heaven.
Amen.
The bad news is that we're traveling there together. It's easy to get out of sorts with those around us. I love the story of the little boy sitting on the step of his home. His face is in his hands, and he's sitting like that. And his dad comes home. He sees his son and says, "Son, what in the world is wrong with you? You look like you've lost your best friend." And the little boy looked up at his dad and said, "Well, Dad, just between you and I, I'm having trouble getting along with that wife of yours." I heard another story about a little girl who was forced to eat alone at a table because she had disobeyed her parents, and Therefore, they were disciplining her, and they said, all right, sweetie, you're going to have to eat by yourself over there by yourself. And so the little girl sat down, and the parents were trying to ignore her because they were trying to teach her again about telling the truth and so forth like that. And as they were sitting at the table, they heard the little girl pray, dear Lord, I thank you for preparing a table for me in the presence of my enemies. Satan delights to get us at odds with one another. If Satan can get us to become annoyed and upset and out of sync with the saints, our mission, of course, is compromised. And so, as we're learning from this series of going the second mile with one another, we see that our relationships are often vulnerable and can be ruptured quite easily if we're not careful. Again, if we don't work at it, our idiosyncrasies will become irritants and our unity will unravel. We read just a moment ago from Ephesians chapter 4. At that third verse where Paul has admonished, he says, I'm begging you, I'm beseeching you, and he says that you walk with lowliness and gentleness and long-suffering. And then he says, listen, you need to be bearing with one another. Cut your brothers and sisters some slack. Bear with one another. Then in that third verse of Ephesians 4, he says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, Paul is writing in this 15th chapter of the book of Romans. Paul is writing to the believers at the church in Rome, not the Roman Catholic Church, the church in Rome. And he's writing to these believers to the church in Rome. And again, there was some division. We saw that last week in chapter 14. And in chapter 14, again, he talked about the fact that some people thought it was okay to do this and some people thought it was okay to do that. And he says, listen, quit judging one another. And the issue here in the church at Rome was they were not divided over their faith of what they believed from the scripture, but they were divided on many non-essentials, or what we would call gray areas. In that 14th chapter here of Romans that we looked at last week, matter of fact, let's just read those first three verses, chapter 14. In chapter 14, Paul is writing to the church that they're divided over non-essentials. And so in verse chapter 1, verse 14, he says, receive or accept one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things. They were having these conflicts over doubtful things, and it primarily was about a diet. One was a vegetarian and the other was a meat eater. And the vegetarian thought the meat eater was wrong, and the meat eater thought the vegetarian was wrong, and there was this conflict in the church at Rome. And some of the conflict had to do with the fact that meats had been offered as sacrifices to the false gods. And then after they were offered as a sacrifice, they were taken down to Bob the Butcher. And Bob the Butcher sold the meats that had been offered as a sacrifice. Well, some people saw that meat, though it was offered to an idol now in the butcher shop, as an abomination. And so they were butting heads in the church at Rome. They were butting heads over non-essential matters. They weren't butting heads over what does the Bible have to say. they were butting heads over these non-essential. And here's what happens. We put labels, don't we? These vegetarians looked at the meat eaters and said, wow, well, that's a bunch of liberals. And the meat eaters over here looked at the vegetarians, said, my word, that's a bunch of legalists. And they were butting heads over non-essentials. Now, here in this 15th chapter, look at verse 12 in chapter 14. We're building the foundation here. He says in verse 12, rather than judging each other, he says in verse 12, so that each of us shall give an account of himself to God. You're not going to account of what I do, and I'm not going to give an account of what you do. And so then he says in verse 13 of chapter 14, therefore, let us not judge one another anymore. Don't be picky at one another. Go the second mile. And don't judge one another over idiosyncrasies, over, again, not essentials, over these matters that really don't, that are personal preferences. Don't judge one another. Not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. We're not to judge one another. He says we're not to be a stumbling block to one another. And if something we do is a stumbling block to somebody, then we should understand that may not be right for us to do it, although it's not wrong. If it's a stumbling block to someone, it may not be good. Now go to verse 7 in chapter 15. In verse 13 of chapter 14, he says, don't be judging one another. That's negative. In verse 7 of chapter 15, he says, we need to accept one another. That's positive. Look at it. He says, verse 7, chapter 15, therefore receive or accept one another just as Christ also received us to the glory of God. And again, that word receive means to take to oneself or to receive, suggesting a welcome. Paul is saying, listen, brothers and sisters, we've been washed in the blood of Christ, and we need to be accepting of one another rather than always judging and looking at the faults of one another. And obviously, the to accept is the opposite of reject or judge. Now, how can we accept one another when there are so many controversial issues that divide us? Now, notice verse 7, as well as verse 13 of chapter 14, both began with the word therefore. And go back to your high school English class, and high school English would teach you when you see the word therefore at the beginning of a sentence, you say to yourself, what is it there for? What's it there for? Now that's really profound, isn't it?
Amen.
So he says, therefore, both in verse 13 of chapter 14 and verse 7 of chapter 15. So we need to say to ourselves, what is it there for? And he's saying, we should not be divided over things, for example, like music taste. Even in Christian music. A lot of people like contemporary Christian music. Many of us prefer traditional Christian music. Is one better than the other? No, not really. Again, if your spirit is lifted by contemporary music, Christian music, then praise God. But personally, I can't understand any of it. I said, what are they singing? What are they singing? What are the words? To me, the message of a song is just as important as the message that comes from this pulpit.
Sure.
If you don't understand the words of what it's saying, what benefit is it?
That's right. Yeah.
Again, Miss Elena sang that great hymn. Oh, to grace how great a debtor. Daily I'm constrained. We sang a moment ago, peace, peace, wonderful peace. Now that speaks to my spirit personally.
Amen.
If it doesn't yours, that's okay. We get out of sorts about that. One's not better than the other. Here's a good one. Here's a good one we get out of sorts about. We get out of sorts over Bible versions. Bible versions. This Bible version I hold in my hand is the King James. I love it. I preach from it. I've memorized it for 50 years. But I also love the New King James. And I tell people, my allegiance is to King Jesus.
Amen.
Not King James.
Amen.
King Jesus is who I serve. But people get out of sorts. I had an email this week. Email this week saying, you know, I'm kind of looking for a church. And I was wondering about your church. And I wonder what kind of music y'all do. And then I knew as soon as he had this one, I knew where they were coming from. What version of the Bible do you use? And you won't find that on our webpage because people are looking for it. I mean, the negative people, those who are picking at you are looking for it because they're King James only. And again, they bow down to King James rather than King Jesus.
Amen.
I knew what this guy's looking for. You know what I said? I said, our Bible in the pew is King James. I'm preaching from the New King James right now. And I have doctrinal reasons why I personally prefer the New King James and among others. The personal pronouns of our Lord and of the Holy Spirit and of God are capitalized in the New King James, where the Holy Spirit is referred to as it in the Old King James. Now, is one better than the other? It's preferences. A lot of people love the NIV, the New International Version. A lot of people like the ESV, the English Standard Version. Listen. It's not what version of the Bible you have. It's that Bible in your heart and life. That's what matters.
Amen.
And so again, we get sidetracked with these things. I heard a preacher say one time that if you didn't get saved through the King James Bible, you weren't saved. That's blasphemy. That's blasphemy. I mean. That's about as stupid as you could be. But people believe that. They're welcome to believe that. But again, often those kind of people are always judging everyone else. You know, they're putting their long bony finger at everybody else and judging them. Rather than saying, okay, you like the New King James, I still want to read the Old King James. Well, that's fine. It's the Word of God. You like the NIV, then that's fine. That's the Word of God. You like the English Standard Version, that's the Word of God. You see, we get sidelined and divided over peripheral issues, preferences, if you will. Now, when the Bible speaks about an issue clearly, then that saith the Lord. There's no debate over that. The church in Rome was not debating over doctrinal issues of faith. They were divided over peripheral issues. And that's what was dividing them. Now, let me make an important point. When we talk about judging, we're not talking about a sin issue. When the Bible says, thou shalt not, that's clear. That's plain. And therefore, there's no debate about thou shalt not. And the things of sin. But he's not talking about those kind of things. We're not asking to tolerate someone's trespasses. We're to offer forgiveness and love. But again, he's not saying we're just to turn our head when sin comes. Instead, we're called to give grace to those who are wired differently than us. Their differences are sometimes expressed with lifestyle choices, or they may have annoying habits. We're called to bear with someone who is a bore, or sometimes someone who snores. Maybe someone who sneezes or someone who wheezes. Perhaps it's someone who's nosy or rosy. Now, I'll never be a poet, but I'll try.
Amen.
But here's the rub. While the person who may rub me the wrong way may not be sinning against me, I could easily sin against that person by my attitude and by my actions. And I have learned that often I can sin against someone by the very attitude that I give and that I display. And sometimes by actions. And when my attitude and my actions are wrong, then that's sin on my part, not on their part. In a book called People I Could Do Without, Donald Smith presents a commentary on conflictive people. He writes that our pent-up irritations can send us into one of two modes. We can go on a reactionary rampage, which is called rage or road rage, or we can respond with silent seething. It might surprise you to know that the Word of God has a lot to say about this subject. And our passage this morning gives us seven ways that we can tolerate those who try our patience. While it's difficult to put up with people who may drive us crazy, we must learn to bear with those who bug us. So here in Romans chapter 15, quickly we're going to walk through these seven verses. How should we react when people bug us? I'm talking about brothers and sisters. The first thing we are to do is to put up. Look at verse 1. We then, that are strong, ought to bear with the scruples or the infirmities of the weak, and not to please ourselves. Notice it underlined in your Bible, that word ought. We ought. We need to put up. We need ought. Ought says we are obligated to be gracious with others. We are so short sometimes with other people. But it says we ought to, again, be gracious. And then he uses the word bear in verse 1. Bear means to endure patiently and to be indulgent. The idea is being long-suffering and slow to anger. To bear with someone is to be willing to suspend a rightful demand out of consideration for the plight of the weakness of another. Now you know as well as I know, we don't tolerate very much today. We'll sound off so quick, we run off, or we'll run somebody else off. I mean, that's pretty much where we're at. But we seldom bear with people. We're called to endure frustrations of living closely with others in the family of God. were to tolerate disputable matters about which we might disagree, but we are brothers and sisters in Christ. And that should cause us to put up. We're challenged here to restrain our natural reaction toward odd or difficult people by just letting them be themselves. Now look at the last part of verse 1. He says, I want you to put up. You ought to do it. You ought to bear it. In the last part of verse 1, he says, and not to please ourselves. We are so self-centered sometimes. It's all about me. No, it's all about our Lord.
Amen.
And we are to be followers of Him. Going back to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 2, we read a moment ago. He tells us there that we aren't to cut others some slack. And he says, I beseech you, or I beg you in verse 1. Then in verse 2, he tells us several things. He says that we are how we walk with all lowliness. We're to deal with our pride issues. Then he says, with long suffering. We're to be gentle, then long suffering, patient, and of course, bear with one another. So, again, we are to put up. Then he says in verse 2, we are to build up. Look at it. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good leading to edification. Verse 1 says we put up. Verse 2 says we build up. That word edification in the last part of verse 2 is literally a destruction term. God says, I want you to practice edification. I want you to build other people up. We are so quick to tear people down. We're so quick to criticize. But to build others up. I received this week in the mail one of the sweetest notes I've received in a long time. And this person simply said, from the minute I walked through the door of this church, I felt accepted, I felt loved, I felt like I was a part of this family.
Amen.
The moment I walked through the door.
Amen.
I mean, that's such a tremendous compliment to this church. And it reflects what my heart reflects as far as wanting this church to be, again, a hospital, not a museum.
Amen.
But again, build up. That's what we're here to do, is to build up. It's so easy to criticize someone. It's so easy to tear down. It takes no skills at all to tear something down. But it does take skills to build up.
That's right.
That's what he's saying in verse 2. Let each of us please his neighbor. Why? For his good leading to edification. Not only are we to put up and build up, but thirdly, he says, look up, verse 3. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproach you fell on me. We can put up when we build up, but we can only do that if we are looking up. And verse 3 says, we are to be looking up to Jesus. I love that verse. In Hebrews, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross and suffered that pain. We are to be looking up. He quotes Psalm 69 and verse 9 to show us that Jesus embraced the insults of irritating people. He didn't please himself, and he took the reproaches. And I believe that if you're finding yourself getting mad, upset, at people, then you're probably not looking at Jesus enough.
Amen.
I love that account found in Matthew chapter 17 and verse 8, where again Jesus and the disciples are on the Mount of Transfiguration. They said, Lord, is it good for us to be here? Had we better build three tabernacles here? And all of a sudden, the disciples saw no one but Jesus only. That's the only thing they saw was Jesus. It literally transformed them. I'll never forget, I was a young preacher, about 27, 8 years old, something like that. I was attending a meeting in Kansas City, Missouri, at the Kansas City Baptist Temple. Great church, founded years ago. And it's always kind of what I would do when I'm visiting great churches. When people were kind of gone, I would just meander privately. I went and stood behind the pulpit of that church. And I looked down from the pulpit and I saw the words on that pulpit. The word said, we would see Jesus.
Amen.
That has stuck with me for many years. My heart's desire. We would see Jesus. You see, we find here that we are to put up, that we are to build up, we're to look up. And then in verse 4, he says, we need to grow up. If we're going to be bearing and accepting of one another, we need to grow up. Look at verse 4. For whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we through patience and the comfort of the Scripture might have hope. He says, listen, it's time to grow up. Patience here means endurance and comfort. In verse 4 speaks of encouragement. And the Bible encourages us so that again, that we can be filled with hope. Hope that others will change, but mostly hope that we will change. He talks about growing up. How do we grow? We grow from the Scripture. Look, he said in verse 4, the patience and comfort of the Scripture might have hope. Remember 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2 says, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the Word that they might grow thereby. How do we grow? We grow from this Word. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for instruction, for correction, according to 1 Timothy chapter 3. We are to grow. So we're to put up, build up, look up, grow up. And fifthly, he says, I want you to stand up. Verse 5. Now, may God of patience and comfort grant you to be like-minded toward one another, according to Christ Jesus. So he says, it's time to stand up. Instead of slamming each other and trying to live Christian life on our own. God wants us to keep us from division. God wants to keep us from strife. And since God bears with us, that is, God's patient with us. And that's what bearing means. It means we're patient. And since God is patient with us, we must be willing to be patient with those who have fallen down, or again, who are different from us. Now look at what he says in that fifth verse about standing up. He uses the term like-minded. He says, now may the God of patience and comfort grant you to be what? Like-minded. What? To toward
who?
One another. We're not always going to see everything eye to eye. We're going to be like-minded when it comes for standing up for the cause of Christ. I love the story of the 10-year-old boy who climbed up on the stool of the old soda fountain. Remember those? Mm-hmm. The old soda fountain. The waitress came and says, "What can I get for you?" He said, "How much is a chocolate fudge sundae?" She said, 50 cents. The little boy reached into his pocket, pulled out his change, and began to count. He said, "How much is just a scoop of ice cream?" The waitress said, 35 cents. The little boy said, "Would you give me a scoop of ice cream, please?" He ate his dish of ice cream, left, and the waitress came and cleaned the counter. And there on the counter was 15 cents, 2 nickels and 5 pennies. He had 50 cents to have a chocolate sundae, but he was thinking about the waitress. So he was settled for a dish of ice cream and left 15 cents. Being like-minded. Let us cut people some slack and recognize that we seldom have the whole story. Put up, build up, look up, grow up, stand up. Verse 6, he says, speak up. He says, that you may with what? One mind and one mouth glorify God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. The ultimate goal, that while we are to be accepting of one another and bearing with one another, why don't we do that? That God, our Father, may be glorified. That Jesus, our Savior, may be lifted up. That's why we do that. And that's what he's saying there. Speak up. He says, that we might with one voice and one mind and one mouth glorify God the Father. That phrase, one mind, literally means with one accord. The apostolic church was a church that was with one accord. And I'm so grateful for the unity and the oneness of this great body called Bible Baptist Church.
Amen.
The oneness that we've had for these many years together. I think one of the reasons I want to continue on is because of that great unity. But if we're not careful, we'll forget that. We'll begin to look at something that we don't like. And rather than with one mouth glorifying God, our Father, with one accord, we began to pick at somebody that we may not always agree or like. He says, put up, build up, look up, grow up, stand up, speak up. And lastly, he says in verse 7, step up. We need to step up. When it comes to bearing with one another, when it comes to accepting one another, we need to step up. Look at verse 7 again. Therefore, and remember, what's it therefore? Why did he put it there? Therefore, rather than picking at one another, he says, therefore, receive or accept one another. Just as Christ also received us to the glory of God. We step up when we receive. We step up when we accept one another. Just as Christ has accepted us. We sing that great hymn, just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. Just as I am. That's how God accepts us. And then we grow in grace. And God transforms us. But he accepts us just as we are. He's accepted us. And because Christ has accepted us, we're to accept one another. A congregation that is divisive, quarrelsome, contentious, and judgmental gives the world a reason to ridicule Christ's church and reject the one who gave himself on the Catholic cross that we might have eternal life.
Amen.
Beloved, Christ has received us with all of our faults and failures, our weakness and our wickedness, with our own lack of loveliness and defects of character, spiritual infirmities. Christ has received us. We need to make sure that we receive one another. Let's not be blind, and let's beware of the spirit of Diotrephes, who John said loved to have the preeminence there in 3 John 10. He did not want to receive others. He wanted to be the preeminent one. Paul said that Christ should be the one who has the preeminence in the church.
Amen.
We simply summarize Paul's message by saying, don't judge one another in disputable things. But let's be bearing with one another. Let's be accepting of one another. Let's not be distracted by peripherals, by preferences. But let's keep our eye looking unto Jesus.
Amen.
The author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that set before him endured the cross. One of my favorite preachers used to say, let's keep the main thing, the main thing. And the main thing is Jesus.
Right.
And Jesus said, I be lifted up. That's what we're here to do. We're here to lift up Jesus and teach and preach the word of the living God.
Amen. Amen.
We need to step up by receiving and accepting one another. Our focus needs to be on him and him alone.
Amen.
Let's step together. Heavenly Father, we ask now your sweet spirit would continue to minister in our lives. Father, above all things, I'm praying for the Holy Spirit to continue to bind our hearts as one in Christ's love. Our brother or sister may be doing something that's irritating to us, but we're to be buried and accepting and loving of one another. Not looking at disputable things, but looking at Christ and Christ alone. Speak to our hearts. Bind us as one. Christ, I pray, amen. We sing that verse of invitation, Brother Terry.
Page 500, please. Page 500, cast me not. Old Mitchell said, 500.
Cast me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble roar. One of my brothers, thou art calling.
Do not cast me by.
Jesus, Savior, Savior.
Last words.
The Lord.